Good morning, Elkview Baptist family. All right, we're easing our way in here. Happy New Year. You see it on the screen behind me. I think we have some people that'll be dragging in this morning. They stayed up a little too late last night. Me and Katie did not make it till midnight last night. She worked and I was up early, so we both went to sleep early so we could be here this morning. Well, if you guys look in your bulletin, there's a lot going on here in the next couple of weeks. We have our Mountaineer Food Bank here in about a week and a half. That's back to our second Tuesday of the month. So if you serve with that, remember, we have that coming up. Give me a call. Pastor Charles is starting a new series on Wednesday the 11th. So we have that going as well. And just remember this next week, we're back to our normal with Wednesday nights happening and just a lot of stuff going on. So keep an eye on your bulletin. And don't forget, we still have our Christmas offering going. No, Christmas is over, but we still have it going for the next, I think, probably 2 weeks or so. So just put in on your giving envelope, just Christmas offering. It'll go towards that. So just see the update there in the bulletin. With that, let's open our first service of the year with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we are just grateful for the starting of a new year. And Lord, we are just thankful that you are the same God yesterday, today, and tomorrow. Lord, we are just excited for the opportunity to start this new year with worshiping as a church family together. We pray that as we go through this service and start this year, we would be able to honor you, praise you, and glorify you with everything that we say and do. Lord, we love you and we thank you for all that you've given us, and we pray that we would worship you fully in heart, mind, and spirit today. It's in your Son's precious and holy name we pray. Amen.
Will someone say something?
Without one plea, but the Well, good morning, church. If you would, stand with us and we can worship together. You know, a day like today is a great day to be in church. The first day of the year, 2023. You know, I just self-reflecting here, you know, we think about this time. We look back on a year that may have brought happiness, may have brought sorrow. But, you know, one thing, at least for me, and I hope for you too, that I can rest assured is that this year showed God's love and his mercies, whether they were apparent or not. And I thank the Lord for that. And also, I just want, you know, what better way to start your year than in church? You know, maybe you're wanting to make a change. It could be said, live as though Christ came yesterday, died today, and is coming back tomorrow. There's time, you know, what better to make a change? If you want to do that study guide, if you want to read your Bible more, if you want to pray more, you know, now's the time to do it. And then I'd also encourage you, pray about it. If you have trouble reading, pray. Ask the Lord to help you to read. So here's to the new beginning and the new year. Let's worship together. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow. All your ways are good. All your ways are sure. I will trust in you alone. Higher than my sight, high above my life, I will trust in you alone, in you alone. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow. Whom you love, I'll love. Who you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. I will follow you. Light into the world, light into my life. I will live for you alone. You're the one I seek, knowing I will find all I need. When you move, I move. I will follow you. When you love, I love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. I will follow you. In you there's life everlasting. In you there's freedom. In you there's joy, unending joy. And I will follow. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. When you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. Into the darkness you shine.
the ashes we rise, there's no one like you. None like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise, there's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome with power. Our God. If our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? What can stand against? Greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Awesome in power, our God, our God. The splendor of tries to hide and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God! Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great. And time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son. See how great is our God. the name above all names. You are worthy of all praise. And my heart will sing, how great is our God. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God.
Maybe see it.
Please join me in prayer. Lord Jesus, your word declares that you are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, that which is, which was, and is to come, the Almighty. And Lord, we're mindful of the words we've just sung. Lord, that how great you are. Lord, we think upon you and we know you as the self-existent, unique God. Yes. Lord, that there is none like you, yes. Not even close. You are completely unique. Mm-hmm. You inhabit eternity. And Lord, our hearts look to you as our Redeemer, as our Savior, as our mighty God. Lord, you are the one that we can put our trust and faith in. You are the only one. And Lord Jesus, as we begin a new year, help us commit our hearts to follow you, to seek your will, to read your word that we might know you better, that we might serve you. Lord, help us. Help us serve one another better through love as we love you, that we would love one another and serve one another. So again, Lord, we thank you that you are God Almighty, that you hear our prayers. Lord, that we can put our faith in you. Thank you, Lord, for who you are and just how you bless us every day. Thank you, Lord, for the simple plan of salvation you've given and how you fulfilled that promise by going to the cross. And Lord, as we think about those, even in our fellowship here, we pray for Pastor Bobby that you would help him through this bout with COVID. That, Lord, you'd strengthen him as it please you, O Lord. And Lord, we thank you that Tina Thaxton is back in the area. We pray, Lord, that you'd strengthen her, that you'd encourage her, that you bless her. And Lord, as we begin to think about this future year, Lord, again, above all else, Lord, we want your will for our lives and for this church body, this group of believers called Elkview Baptist Church. Lord, we want to serve you. Lord, bless our pastor as he brings us the word. In Jesus' name, amen.
Not forsaken. Bless you. Well, happy new year. There are burdens present in our congregation this morning and throughout this week that are too heavy to bear. But as we start this new year, we have been reflecting on the greatness of our Father, on the sweetness and reception of our Savior, Jesus Christ, and on the abiding presence of His Spirit. I want to tell you, we can be confident in 2023 as one of God's children that He is with us. And He is able, amen? It's going to be a good year to walk with the Lord. I want to encourage you this morning. I held this up 2 weeks ago, and I want to give you one more shot at it. This is my devotional for this year. They're available at the Welcome Center on your way out. Revival Today, and it gives you a name from history you will recognize, and it gives you how that person's life was deeply impacted by God's working in them on that day, how they yielded, and many times history shows the results. But very uplifting, very encouraging. And I think you'll find it well worthy of meditations. And that's available for $15. And if you really, really want it, you don't have $15, get it anyway and we'll cover you up, okay? I want to invite you to open your Bibles this morning to Galatians. We'll be in Galatians chapter 5 and John chapter 13 in just a few moments. I trust that you're noticing your bulletin with some options and some new things coming in the next week or two. I just want to point out that on Wednesday nights, we have a thriving place here at Elkview Baptist Church. We have the teens meeting next door. We have a Awana program for all ages. We have a nursery. But on Wednesday nights, beginning on January 11th, we'll have two options for adults. Two options right here in the sanctuary, building great relationships with Pastor Curry. And then up in the Berean classroom, we'll be starting a new study called Thriving in Babylon. You can read the description of that in your bulletin. Well, our Bible's open to Galatians 5. You remember probably 15, 20 years ago, at least that long, a worship pastor stepped out on stage and he interacted with this congregation and he said, God is good. And the congregation said, and all the time. And that really caught on. And it swept across the nation, and churches really did recite that in faith, and it was just an affirmation that made sense. We understood it, and we believe it to this day. Now, I want to say our theme this year, I think we can do a similar thing. You see, it says there on the screen, through love, serve one another. So I would say, through love, and you would say, serve one another, and you would say, all right, we're catching right on. Where does this come from in the Bible? Through love, serve one another. In Galatians chapter 5, verse 13, the Bible says, for you, brethren, have been called to liberty. Only do not use liberty as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love, serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even in this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. And as we look at this text and where our theme for this year comes from, I would call our attention to the fact that love in verse 13 and service are interwoven. It is God's intent, the life of Jesus Christ, the life of the apostles post the resurrection, is an illustration of love and service inseparably woven together. You see, love is the foundation, and it is the motivation for our service. When we look at the text this morning, through love, serve one another, the question to be asked is not, how much are you serving at Elkview Baptist Church? The correct question, the most foundational question, is how much are you loving? Because from love will flow the service that remains, that service that has abiding fruit. So through love, we will serve one another. I would remind you of that passage in Corinthians, the love chapter of the Bible, chapter 13, and I'll quote a few things here to you. It says, if you have the gift of languages and you can speak in multiple tongues, it says, but if you lack love, you are like sounding brass in a clanging cymbal. You're just noisy. And then in verse number 2 of that chapter, it says, you may have many gifts that are given to you by the Spirit of God, the gift of prophecy, understanding mysteries and knowledge. You may have faith that is capable of moving obstacles. But if you lack love, It says, I am nothing. So in this context, you see, service that isn't flowing from a foundation and a motivation of the love of God birthed in our heart, that service can actually profit me nothing. So our theme is, through love, we what, church? And we will serve one another. How? Yes, that's the way the Spirit would bid us to serve, from the platform of love. I remind you, verse number 3 of chapter 13 of 1 Corinthians, it says, if I give my goods to feed the poor, if I give my body sacrificially to others, and just let it waste away and be consumed, if I give my body to be burned, but have not love, it profits me nothing. You see, service wrongly motivated will profit me nothing. Someone once said, you can serve in the church. You can serve and think you're serving Christ. You can serve without loving, but you cannot love without serving. So this is our theme, and today the message would illustrate through love, and built on that foundation of the love the Father had for us, compelled by His love, we serve one another. I would like to just put the message today, not so much on the service side, but it is on the love side, the foundation of service through love. So with that in mind, John chapter 13, we read about Christ giving us a love command. John 13, verse number 34, it says, a new commandment I give you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. Do you feel like you're in love this morning? Who are you in love with? I hope you're in love with your spouse. Man, I hope you're in love with your children. But you know, I hope that your fervency and passion for the Lord, it is clearly in a separate category than the love of just those sweet, intimate relationships we so cherish. But Jesus said, I give you a new commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. By this all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love one for another. I see in these verses here a new command that Christ gave us. I see a qualification of that command, and then I see a purpose for that command. So we'll take a quick look at this. The new command is love one another. If we remember the old command, if we could wrap it up in one word, it was called the law, the old covenant, and the new covenant. But the old command was law, and the law is a tutor that brings us to the feet of Jesus Christ. You see, Christ is the fulfillment of the law, and the law points out our sin, but Christ on the cross points out the solution to our sin. So He brings a new command. He's not saying, I want you mindful of 300 plus specific laws. He says, I want you mindful that you set your love and affection on me, and you love like I loved, and you will have fulfilled the law. So the old command is the law. The new command is love. Romans chapter 13 gives us a beautiful verse. You might jot this reference down. Romans 13 verse 8 says, owe no man anything. Now that's not speaking about financial debt. In context, it says, owe no man anything except to love one another. For he who loves another has fulfilled the law. for the commandments. And how many are there? Oh, there's too many for us to recall them all. Oh, my goodness, how can we walk with the Lord and have a clean conscience and a right to a confidence that we are in His grip? How can we remember all those commands? For the commandments, you shall not commit adultery. You shall not murder. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. All these are true and they still apply today. You shall not covet. Oh, and on it goes. And if there are any other commands, all of these are fulfilled. Romans chapter 8 says all of these are fulfilled. Romans 13. They're summed up in this saying, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no harm to a neighbor, verse 10. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. Isn't that beautiful? You see, the new commandment is love one another. Love does not commit adultery. Love does not steal, gossip, spread rumors, envy, covet. Oh, I'm so thankful for this new command where Christ said, look, let me tell you what to focus on. You focus on loving one another, and you focus on abiding in me, staying attached to the vine. And the source of love is going to flow from heaven through His children and through to each other. Through love, serve one another. Serve one another through love. You see, love, here's what Jesus taught us about. Service motivated by love. He said, love will do good to our enemies. You see, we can remember that the Father in heaven sends rain on the just and the unjust in Matthew chapter 6. Jesus taught us that love will pray for those who misuse you or even persecute you. You see, Jesus prayed that way when He said, Father, lay not this sin to their charge. You know, love will concern itself for a neighbor. Love will serve one another. Jesus is that perfect embodiment of love and service. But not just those expressions of love. Here's another sermon from Jesus. You do recall all these statements Jesus made. Help me finish this one. Jesus said, speak the truth. That's right. Speak the truth in love. You see, all of our Christian service needs to be motivated by the love the Father has bestowed on us and freely giving us and lavished us with. And then it can have an effective, eternal, redemptive purpose, that love, when we express it back out to others. Speak the truth. Love will speak the truth. You know, I think we could, we say, through love, serve one another. Serve one another through love. And we can say, God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. But I think our culture also needs to remember, speak the truth in love. Church, in love, we will. Yes. That's a sermon from Jesus Christ. So love will speak the truth. You know, Jesus did that for us. He lived this perfect embodiment of love and service to people. There was a person caught in adultery, and Jesus didn't just say, oh, well, that really doesn't matter. Times have changed. Jesus said, go and sin no more. He addressed the issue that separated that person's eternity from their Creator. He addressed the issue, sin. And He called them to repentance. You know, an audience came before Jesus one day, and they had suspected that the Galileans up north of them had their sacrifice and the blood of that sacrifice mixed with their own blood as the Romans came in and violated that sacrifice and slaughtered those people coming to make a sacrifice. And this crowd of people that came before Jesus speculated that something must have been really drastically, wickedly wrong with those Galileans for that to have happened. And Jesus spoke the truth in love to that audience that day, and He said these words, unless you repent, you will all likewise perish. Wow. You know, Jesus was pretty radical with the way he teached, didn't he? He spoke the truth in love. But the love, the way he displayed it, caused the truth he spoke to be just perfectly presented. Now we need to be like that. He says, love others the way I loved you. You know, Jesus was in front of a powerful man named Pilate. And Pilate, he speculated a question out loud in front of Jesus. And Pilate said, what is truth? And Jesus had previously been preaching. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And right in front of Pilate's ear, he said, I am bearing witness to the truth. To you, Pilate. Wow. You know, love will speak the truth in an endearing, tender, direct, clear, discernible way. You know, there was a self-willed follower that followed with Jesus, and he had done the best he could to keep up with all what Jesus was showing and teaching, but he wasn't really yet controlled by the Spirit of God. And this self-willed follower heard Jesus talking about going to the cross. And he said, no, that can't happen. Not to you, Jesus. And Jesus spoke the truth in love to Peter that day. He said, get behind me, Satan. You are an offense. You are not mindful of the things of God, but of the things of man. So I would just encourage us this morning to remember, we speak the truth in love. That's how we serve one another. Well, Satan's strategy would be to remove agape love from our hearts. He would like to diminish it with timidity and fear. Satan would like very much to replace the agape love of God and keep us from speaking truth. There's other strategies, the way Satan would use it. He would like to replace agape love with cynicism, anger, and hate. But no. What did Christ say? He said, a new commandment I give you, that you love one another. And if you remember our passage we read this morning, he said, love one another. Well, that's easy. I've got to work at loving you guys, and you've got to work at loving each other, and you've got to work at loving me. We're a family. We're the church. Oh, I get that, Pastor. But then right behind the phrase, through love, serve one another, he gave an interpretation of it, and he said, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Well, that takes it. Yeah, through love we serve one another in the church, but thou shalt love thy neighbor. That takes it outside the church. And that's where it gets tough. So there's both dimensions. Satan's strategy would be to replace the agape love that we are to be receiving from above and conduiting out of our lives. He would replace that with just frustration and anger. Oh, let it not be. A new commandment I've given you. Love one another. And then notice, please, the qualification that Christ put on this. If you'll look in John 13, we have a new command, love one another, and then a qualification. I want you to love each other as I loved you. That's the qualification. Now, that's illustrated for us in the foot washing that Jesus did. John chapter 13, if you'll notice verse 3, here's the foot washing. Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he had come from God and was going to God, rose from supper and laid aside his garments and took a towel and girded himself. I want you to notice, before Jesus performed that lowly task of washing feet, it is noted here he was absolutely secure in his relationship with the Father. You see, our security in the throne room and taking advantage of the promises of God, that Jesus has gone before us and he is created a space where all of the blood-washed children of God have the right to come in the throne room, and we are received. But that confidence and that security that comes from knowing I have been forgiven, I am loved with an immeasurable love. I can't comprehend it. I can't fully embrace it. But I am free in Christ to follow Him. What a wonderful gift this salvation is. That beautiful presence that where we are confident we're in the presence of God, that is where service flows out of that. That is where an authentic love flows out of that experience. Our confidence, Jesus said, I know where I came from and I know where I'm going. Do you know where you came from and know where you're going? And that through Christ, you're going to heaven. You see, in the gratitude of that gift of salvation, we can love like we've never loved before. Jesus said in verse number 3 that he had come from God. He was going to God. Verse 4, he rose from supper, laid aside his towel and garments. He took a towel, girded himself, and after that he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them and the towel with which he was girded. You see, the qualification that Christ is giving us here, he said, I give you a command, go love one another, but let me tell you how. Do it the way I did it. And now this is an illustration right here. Peter and John had been preparing the Passover meal. They had been sent by Jesus to get things ready. They had spent the whole day. They secured a lamb. They probably took it over to the temple and had it slaughtered by the priest. They had the lamb cooked and made ready. They secured an upper room where this Last Supper took place and all the other ingredients needed for the Passover meal. And when the other disciples and Jesus began to arrive that evening, everything was prepared. Everything was in its place. But one thing was overlooked. And Jesus waited. He paused. He wanted to see, would anyone respond to that one thing that had been overlooked? The meal began. The food was being eaten. It was a good time, nice fellowship. And right in the middle of the meal, Jesus stood up. And he took off his dignified robes. And he began to look very lowly in form. He looked like a servant would look with his undergarment. And then he went over and found a wash basin and began to wash the people's feet there in the room. You know, he says, love like this. Express your love not merely in words, but in tangible acts of sacrificial service. Oh, what love the Father has for us. Oh, what examples he's given us. He says, love like this. When a husband loves, he subjugates his own wants and desires to the needs of his wife and his family. When a mother loves, she isn't irked by having to give up her agenda or her plans for the sake of her children. When an athlete loves, it's the team that matters, and it's the victory of the team, not winning the individual accolade for self. When a Christian loves, it's others that are considered as we think about ourself. Wow. You know, Corinthians says that we are to be rooted and grounded in love in Ephesians. And in Corinthians says it is being rooted and grounded that we will be compelled, that the love of Christ compels us, motivates us. Such a simple message this morning, and it's interwoven throughout the whole New Testament. How did Jesus do what he did in service? It's because the pipeline of love was flowing through him. He was in touch with the agape love, and he embodied it, and he shared it. Well, there's a purpose. There's a purpose. If you go back to our text this morning, it says, I give you a new command. And here's the qualification. I want you to love like I loved. But now here's the purpose. People will know you're my disciple. They'll know it will mark you. You know, we have no problem remembering certain symbols. Our culture embeds it upon us. I think we all can recognize when there's a cardboard box sitting on your porch and it's got a smile. It's got a smile going up. We know what that is. Amazon's got their symbol there, don't they? I think most of us would recognize what Walmart's symbol is. You know, there's not a car going down the road. When I see their little symbol, I go, oh, that's that brand. I know. Well, the Father has so ordained it that this love that's uncharacteristic of the world's love would be the mark upon us. So, church, how does it work? It says, through love we... and we serve one another. That's how it works. Now, we're not up to the task. I just want to comfort you with a couple thoughts, and then we'll be done. You and I aren't up to the task. Humanly speaking, we're not. I recall James and John walked with Jesus. They had a couple years' experience under their belt of being right beside the only begotten Son of God, and they were still doing things like, Jesus, do you want us to call down fire from heaven on these inhospitable people? They were full of zeal, but the love wasn't there. And then I remember another occasion where all the disciples were together, and there was this Gentile lady from Tyre and Sidon, and she cried out loud to Jesus. She was following Jesus and the disciples around, and she kept saying, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David. My daughter is severely demon-possessed." And she said this three or four times at least. And after clamoring behind Jesus and the disciples began to say, okay, Jesus, send her away. We don't minister to those type of people. We're not going to do anything for her, so send her away. And after a bit, Jesus conversed with the lady, and he finally said, "O woman, great is your faith. Let it be as you have desired." And her daughter was healed of that demonic spirit. You know, love like this. We aren't up to this. The disciples did learn it, though, didn't they? Through love, serve one another. And after the resurrection, after the filling of the Holy Spirit into their life, they learned to, through love, boy, they served like they had never thought they could. So the foundation of our service this year is through love. Would you stand together with me, please? We could, if you don't mind, let's bow our heads together and call ourselves to a time of prayer. I want to give you a start to your prayers this morning. Our heads are bowed. I'd ask you to start your prayer maybe this way. Here's two options. Father, I am content with my comprehension of your love. I start your prayer that way. Or, Father, help me experience your love more completely. Which is most fitting for you? Would you go to prayer now? Our pastors are at the front. If we can be of help to you today, is your heart saying, Father, help me experience your love more completely? Pray that out before the Lord. Maybe you need the touch of the Lord's salvation. If we can be of help to you, our pastors are here at the front. Would you look up this way? So our theme this year is through love. Serve one another. Now we're going to lead us in closing prayer, basing our prayer from Ephesians chapter 3, verse 17. Would you bow with me? Our Father, we come into your presence and thanking you for the privilege of coming before a great, benevolent, attentive Father through the grace bestowed on us of Jesus Christ. And Lord, we are requesting that Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith, that we may know more of him. We are called upon to be rooted and grounded in love. Make us able to comprehend with all the other believers what is the width, the length, the depth, the height of the love of Christ. To know the love of Christ, which passes our knowledge, and that we might be filled with all the fullness of God. Oh, Father, we aren't content with our understanding and our comprehension in our expression of your love. Now to the one who is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we ask or think, by the power that works in us, may glory be to God through the name of Jesus Christ. We ask, amen. God bless you. Happy New Year. Have a great day.